Good morning, fellow friends. I'm very, very happy to welcome you to this news program on NPA Guide 2021 moratorium. Because after Supreme Court decision on moratorium, this is required a very, very important attention from all the parts of the from the bank also, as well as from the charter accountant also. So the maximum extent I am going to cover. So it is nothing but it's a normal NPA only. But what are the important things that you have to see that I am going to cover here? But before going to that, I want to give some, just like revision, I am going to say what has happened so far in this moratorium situation that is due to this COVID. But when the Indian economy, because of COVID situation, the Indian economy has fallen down. Even all business people, they have fallen into a lot of problems. So Reserve Bank of India, due to this COVID situation, they have given a lot of concession to the MSME units as well as to the other units. Other than MSME units, they have given some concession. What are the concessions given? And one team, they have gone to Supreme Court that they want to extend the moratorium, and the Supreme Court said, okay, we will consider, but you have to wait for the our final terms, final order. Then only you are answerable. Then only you have to classify the NPA. Now, the RBI has issued the surplus with reference to MSME. This surplus I have already circulated to you during the previous sessions. These three surplus have been given importance, and these three surplus, please go through. Thoroughly, so that when you go to the audit, what are the important things that you have to verify? One thing I want to say that you have to verify not only NPA, but what are the conditions that are put in that circular. That conditions have to be fulfilled by the branch or bank, then only they are eligible to get the moratorium benefits or some concession. So this point you have to bear in mind. And this is a RBI circular with reference to the moratorium. That is, it is not with reference to moratorium. This is a concession they have given with reference to MSME. So they have issued three surplus, one 11/2/2020 and 6/8/2020. And in all three days, the account should be standard. And here I want to highlight only standard assets as on 1/1/19, 1/1/20, 1/3/2020. This point you have to bear in mind during the audit. And this MSME circular with reference to RBI is applicable for the aggregate limit of funded and non-funded outstanding. It is not sanctioned. It is outstanding, not exceeding 25 crores. So the MSME RBI circular is applicable for the limits up to 25 crores. And third one is whether it's a GST or without GST also, the scheme is applicable. And the third thing is the NPA should, even if it slipped to NPA and remain in same status up to the date of implementation. So the date on which the scheme has to be implemented, up to the date of implementation, even though the asset has fallen down to substandard.
Sir, no, she's coming.
Substandard. Audio then that should not be given effect. So that means there is no downgrading. There is no downgrading here. This permitted. This is a very, very important thing. So normally bankers, they won't do the downgrading. And very, very important thing is, once if any restructuring is done to the MSME, either as per the circular of 1/1/19, 1/1/11/2020 or 6/8/2020, no further restructuring has to be done. This point has to be bear in mind during the audit. Because 1/1/19, one party has given the restructuring. Then, even though after implementation, if that asset has become NPA, then what the manager they will do, they will once again do the restructuring as per the circular 11/2/2020 and 1/1/2020. This should not be there. This is a very, very important thing that you have to bear in mind while doing the audit. That is, once if any restructuring is done, that should not be done once again for the same unit, and there is no downgrading possible. Another thing with reference to the important point with reference to MSME is, the unit should have got Udayam registration certificate. This is a basic thing. Even without Udayam registration certificate, I came to know that most of the bankers, now they have classified those units as MSME. See, when you want to classify one unit as MSME, that should have got the Udayam registration or the SSI certificate, the entrepreneur memorandum, Udyog Aadhar certificate. Now they say that it is Udayam registration. And when a very important point that you have to bear in mind during the audit is Udayam registration certificate should be availed by the existing MSME on or before 31/3/2021. Otherwise, that unit has not been treated as Udayam MSME unit. So as an auditor, during this year, you have to verify whether the unit has got the Udayam registration or not. That point, important point that you have to see. And other things we have already discussed, that is aggregate exposure should not exceed 25 crores. But for this, you have to, they insist that a chartered accountant has to give you a certificate stating that the aggregate exposure has not exceeded 25 crores. For that, CS certificate is required. And GST, you have to see the GST registration certificate and check the status. That is, on 1/1/2020, the account should be standard. See here, the 1/1/19, 1/1/20 or 1/3/2020, the account should be standard. So that means a substandard account of MSME, they are not eligible to get it, thus get the restructuring benefit. So this point you have to bear in mind. Next one is, this year, in the LFA, they say that the chartered accountant has to verify SMA 0, 1, 2. These things also you have to confirm it along with your NPA classification. This point also you have to bear in mind. So check the point number 5. Check overdues as on the relevant date. This point you have to bear in mind. Next point is, and with reference to the other portion, with reference to other portion wherein the Supreme Court has given decision, it is based on the regulatory package of COVID-19. So here we have got four circulars. These four circulars have also, we have already discussed in depth in the previous session. And these four circulars are applicable for this NPA classification. And the important thing is, in this COVID circular, initially, the RBI has said the asset should be standard as on 29/2020. This point you have to bear in mind. The asset should be standard as on 29/2021. Then, second point that is the moratorium with reference to interest, installment, EMI, the RBI is extended from 1/3/2020 to 31/5/2020 and it was further extended to 31/8/2020. This is nothing but account should be standard as on 29/2020. From there up to 31/8/2020, it's a moratorium period against which no change in status is permitted. Though the account has slipped into NPA, no further change is allowed. So there is no slippage of NPA during this moratorium period. This is very, very important thing. So the first thing is we have to see that account should be standard as on 29/2020. But we are going to the audit for the period from 1/4/2020 to 31/3/2021. That means you have to go and do the working for the earlier year. That is 1/4/19 to 31/3/2020. One can say that. One can take a stand that the previous statutory auditor, he has classified that account as standard as on 31/3/2020. So we have not classified that stand also you can take, but to be on the safer side, please do the working as on 29/2/2020. If the account is restructured before 1/1/19, yes, they are permitted. They are also permitted, sir. Kesav, see, as per the present norms, the account should be standard. Previously, it was restructured. Now, again, they are eligible as per the RBI circular. Please go through the RBI circular. They can do it. And principal and interest, see, in this period, the moratorium is for 6 months. And principal, interest, EMI, they have been postponed. The borrower need not pay the amount. They need not pay the amount to the bank. When even if they pay it, okay, the bankers, they accept it. And here there is one very important thing. The party has to give consent. This is a very, very important thing that you have to verify during the year, whether the party, whether the borrower has given his consent to avoid moratorium or not. If it is given, okay. If it is not given, or that is the effect on Supreme Court order. So the consent to avoid moratorium letter, you must see during the audit. This is another thing. And during the moratorium, the RBI said that interest need not be paid. Interest need not be paid. It can be accrued. It can be accumulated. It's in the form of simple interest also, they can do it. But everything is being clarified by the Supreme Court in its final order. And because of this moratorium period, there should not be no civil effect. There should not be no civil effect. This point you have to bear in mind. See, why I insisted that in one of my stock audit cases, so I have gone for stock audit, that the statutory auditor has classified the account as standard as on 31/3/2020. But on my verification during the stock audit, I found that that's a CC account. The CC account has not been renewed within a period of 180 days from the due date. So on 17/1/2020, that account has become bad. That account has become NPA. But that the statutory auditor has classified that account by ignoring this point, saying that it's a standard asset. So my advice is, you once again do the NPA applicability for the previous year also. If it is marginally exempted, okay, you can ignore it or you can take your own decision. But if it is the NPA, according to you, that even on 29/2020, if that account is not a standard asset, then that account is not eligible to get the moratorium benefit, which has been announced by the RBI. This point you have to bear in mind, standard as on 29/2020. With reference to term loan rescheduling and with reference to cash credit rescheduling, as for the COVID circular, the account should be as usual. 29/2020, it is a standard asset, and recovery of interest only is being postponed. There is no waiver of interest, but a lot of people, they say that the government is going to waive the interest. There is no such thing. There is no question of waiver. They say that only the payment has been postponed to 31/8/2020. Interest debited has to be paid immediately after the completion of the deferment period, that is after the moratorium period, subject to Supreme Court decision. And banks have got the power to convert the interest portion of funded interest portion as funded interest term. That is, during the moratorium, they've already given in the circular that whatever interest accrued that during the moratorium period, that has to be converted into FITL, that is funded interest term loan. And that has to be paid on or before 31/3/2021. This point you have to bear in mind. So for funded interest term loan, the interest portion they have to add, and that has to be treated as a separate term loan. It's a bullet payment on 31/3/2021, that interest has to be paid. So you need not bother. The only concern is that there should be a proper loan agreement to convert the interest portion to FITL. That point you have to see during the audit. And the DP, that is stock submission calculation of DP, has been postponed up to 31/3/2021. That is, they have to regularize the submission of stock statement on or before 31/3/2021. And during this moratorium period, downgrading is not possible. That is, you need not worry whether that account has become standard, from standard to substandard. You have to forget it. You have to simply ignore the moratorium period. You have to think that 29/2020 is after 29/2020, you have to directly go to 19/2020. You need not bother about the moratorium period changes. This is a point, important point that you have to bear in mind. It's only a revision. Just I'm repeating the same thing for your And what the Supreme Court said.
Hello.
They said.
Hello.
Yes.
Sir, may I have a question?
Put it in the chat box, sir. Yeah, you just ask.
Sir, I just want to know, one account is sanctioned on 1/1/2019.
Yes.
Okay, and 1 year completed 1/1/2020. After after 6 months complete in moratorium period, an account is not renewed in moratorium. Is it called NPA or we wait for the another 6 months after moratorium?
So just wait for the final presentation, sir. Then after that, you ask this because the same question, same thing I have covered here. Because you have to wait. You please just wait for 10 minutes or 15 minutes. Then you ask this, sir, after the guideline with reference to moratorium.
Okay.
The thing is, you are absolutely correct. If it, you, for that only we are conducting this session, sir. You just wait for just a half an hour. At the end of the program, you ask me anything with reference to this. Yeah, and sir, if FITL is not repaid as on 31-3, yeah. No, actually, Jagdish sir, you asked, if FITL is not, see, the due date of payment is 31-3-2021. From there, it goes to the next year. And FITL, if it is not paid 31-3-2021, you need not classify that account as NPA. Because from the due date, you have to add 90 days and it goes to the next year. It goes to the next year. And another point with reference to our friend asked, only one time restructuring is allowed. See, what is the implementation period? During that period only, you have to, you need not downgrade it. And if it falls between the moratorium period, that due date has to be shifted to the next day. So this answer I want to submit. I think, sir, have you asked that question? Who has asked this question, sir? With reference to restructuring done on 1/1/19. See, the restructuring, if the implementation due date falls within the moratorium, you have to shift to after that unit. That's a very, very simple logic. That's the thing you bear in mind, and you can definitely come to the conclusion after this, after the completion of the program. And the finance ministry, what's the view on this about the finance ministry? Finance ministry said it is, they say that it is very difficult to finalize the accounts of the public sector banks due to the Supreme Court classification. They stay on the classification of accounts. In the interim order, they say that no further downgrading, no further NPA is allowed till the final order is being given. That's the interim order. They say that up to 31-8-2020, if the standard, if the account is standard, no further downgrading for no further NPA is allowed. This is an order given in the interim order passed by the Supreme Court. Now, based on this Supreme Court, the Finance Ministry has appealed to the Supreme Court saying that it is, they found it very difficult to finalize those accounts. So that's a grievance that has been raised by the Finance Ministry. Even RBI has also pleaded before Supreme Court that if the classification is being delayed, it has got a lot of impact on the economy. So based on that, the Supreme Court, it has passed the order as a final order on 23-3-2021. This order also I have submitted to you. The Supreme Court is being headed by Ashok Bhushan, Justices Ashok Bhushan and Subhash Reddy and Justice Emma Shah. They pronounced the verdict in the case of Small Scale Industries Manufacturer Association versus Union of India. Now, in that case, they say that we want extension of moratorium. But Supreme Court said there is no extension of moratorium because on 31-8-2020, the moratorium ends. So the Supreme Court has pronounced its order on 23-2021. And the main thing about the Supreme Court, what is the main thing is there should not be no interest on interest, no penal interest, no compound interest. These three things they said, no interest on interest, these three things should not be there during the moratorium. They say that the moratorium is being given by the government, by the Reserve Bank of India. So there is no default is arising from the party side. So there should not be a penal interest. There should not be a charge on interest on interest. There should not be a cumulative interest that the banks, they have to charge with the account. Then if the bank has already charged, if the borrower has already paid, the excess amount has to be returned to the party or has to be adjusted to the loan amount. This is a very, very important thing that this year you have to see whether the branch has charged simple interest or other forms of interest on interest, penal interest, or compound interest. That point you have to see. And it just the benefit is available to all sectors of the industry, all sectors of the business, all loan sectors. So the initially the government say that the benefit is available only to 2 crores, and that too they have classified some 10 category only for housing sector, and they are given a list. But the Supreme Court say that there should not be any disparity between the borrowers. This benefit should be given to all. This is an important thing that the Supreme Court has given in its order. So does that mean interest cannot be charged on FITL? See, FITL is a loan. FITL is a loan. Any loan has to be charged with interest. Only the interest portion is being converted into a new loan. For the new loan, as usual, you have to charge the interest. Only during moratorium, interest on interest is not allowed. But after moratorium, the loan is converted as FITL. Then even from 2020, they have to convert into FITL. From that date, as usual, the bank, they have to charge interest. And this loan has to be closed, FITL loan has to be closed on or before 31/3/2021. Means interest charge on FITL. Yes, sir. Amar sir, every interest has to, even it is a loan. It is a loan. It is a loan. It's only for loan, the banks, they have to charge interest. So they never say that only during moratorium, only the benefit has been given and not after that. So the Supreme Court has said that this is a very important thing. And now we are going to the important area where we have to concentrate during the audit. That is the NPA classification. In the court, they rejected and say that some borrowers who had not applied for moratorium and had been paying EMI. Sir, I will come to that point. And who has raised that question? Vikram sir, I will come to the point that I will cover in the last part. And whether banks have already made the reversal or we do not do it through MOC. If the banks, so you put it in the question available to everyone. You put directly to me, okay, very good. And you have to do it. You have to do it. If the banks, they have not do the reversal, you have to do the reversal on your own in the MOC. And the rate of interest to on fill on FITL is same as the principal loan. Amasa, you are correct. Kindly refer the sanction letter. Any loan, not only FITL, not only CC, not only term loan, any loan, you have to refer the sanction letter. Based on the sanction letter only, you have to apply the interest rate. Here, they say that, Supreme Court say that, vote rejection on the following reliefs sought by various petitioners. Total waiver of interest during the moratorium period. People, they asked, we don't want to pay the interest during the moratorium. Supreme Court said, no. And second thing, they never extend the period of moratorium. And to extend the extend the period of invocation of the resolution mechanism, namely 31/12/2020, this is applicable for IBC cases. And we are not going to concentrate this during the audit. And that there shall be sector-wise limit. The government say that up to 2 crores only the benefit is applicable. The Supreme Court say that there is no disparity. There is no disparity is allowed for the relief. That the central government, RBI, must provide for some other relief over and above the offer. And they say that we need further relief from the central government. They need further relief. RBI, they need further relief from the RBI. The Supreme Court said all the relief work that has been undertaken by the government are very much satisfactory. That is, the Supreme Court has said that we are not there to direct the central government to provide additional relief, to provide additional relief from the RBI. See, this is a policy decision because even in one thing they say, just like people, government has also suffered during pandemic because they have provided a lot of relief through the health ministry. So this is a final thing. No further interest. I mean, no interest is allowed. No compounding interest, penal interest, or simple. I mean, interest on interest is allowed during moratorium. This point you have to bear in mind. And no further extensions. Now, we are going to another, the very, very important area, how we have to do it during the, after the Supreme Court order, how we are going to do NPA classification. That is, effect on Supreme Court on moratorium. That is, moratorium ends on 31-8-2020 and with no further extension. No further extension. So, you need not consider the period from 1-3-2020 and 1-8-2020. Even for this year, I want to suggest you those days from your calendar. It's a very, very simple logic. Because this year you have to do the audit. So you have to 1-3-2020 and 31-8-2020 for the purpose of interest, for the purpose of EMI repayment, you just remove it from your calendar. So after 29-2020, it goes directly to 1-9-2020. This is at this point you have to bear in mind during this moratorium NPA calculation. NPA effect, what is the NPA effect due to that order that we are going to discuss it here? What is the NPA effect on banks? What is the effect on the Supreme Court? Effect on the Supreme Court? The bank has clearly said the branch need not classify in few banks. I cannot. I have seen some three banks circular. In all these three circulars, they say that NPA classification has to be done at the head office level. That means they are doing NPA classification through system. So they have previously. Classification has to be done at the branch level. Now, they say that just like provisioning, NPA classification is done at head office level. And our role is to verify whether the NPA classification is done correctly or not. One cannot question that since the NPA classification is done by the head office, whether a chartered accountant has to verify, it is your role. You have to verify the classification. You have to verify the NPA classification. And lot of accounts now, you go this year, you can see lot of accounts have already become NPA because of the thing which you are going to discuss in the next part of the slide. You can see when I approached a banker, when I asked the manager, he said, sir, the branch office has already classified some 5 crore and odd as NPA because of this. Moratorium effect. So they've already done the classification, but as a chartered accountant, you have to verify the very, very important thing that the account should be standard as on 29-2-2020. If you defeat that point, the account is not a standard on 29-2020. So the moratorium benefit is not there, is not eligible to be given to the borrower. So you have to do the audit very safely and I'm moving to the next part of the slide. Now, this is from here. This is the real effect of this presentation. And one thing is those who have availed moratorium benefit. Yes, I request the fellow members who are all going to the audit, kindly ask for the letter. Kindly ask for the letter that has been given by the borrower to the banker that want to avail moratorium benefit. If there is no letter, then the issue is different. The issue is different. Sir, could you please mute all the participants? A lot of noise. Okay. No problem. Yeah, I've muted everyone. Thank you. And Sunit, okay. Based on your direction, I muted everyone. So there are two benefits. One, two things here in the moratorium. One is those who avail the moratorium benefits. Once again, I'm repeating, kindly see the letter. If it is not there, then it is a very, very It is the classification is entirely different. And those who do not avail the moratorium, those who do not avail the moratorium, these two things you have to see. Now I am going for persons, the borrowers who have availed the moratorium benefits. Those persons who have availed the moratorium benefits. And I have classified into two, that is working capital limits and term loan. Now I am going to discuss with the working capital limit. This is applicable for both for agriculture and non-agriculture. There is no separation. They say that working capital limit, that's all. So it is applicable both for agriculture as well as non-agriculture. The account should be standard on 29-2020. Okay, this point. Then accumulated interest during the period of moratorium, as said in the original RBI circular, this interest has to be converted into FITL, funded interest term loan. That is, the period of interest should be 1-3-2020 to 31-8-2020. And FITL has to be paid on or before 31-3-2020. And our friend asked whether interest has to be charged on FITL. Yes, interest has to be charged on FITL because it is a separate loan. It is nothing but interest on interest you are going to charge. So even you can pay the amount in say 1 lakh, 2 lakhs, 3 lakhs, but on or before 31-3-2021, you have to close the loan. DP has got no effect on submission. They say that during the moratorium, they say that stock statement submission is not possible. So they say that they ask the manager, they ask the branch to regularize the stock statement position on or before 31-3-2021. So during this period, you need not bother. During the moratorium period, not the period after the moratorium, you have to see the DP effect. It has to be regularized on or before 31-3-2021. So DP statement has to be computed on or before 31-3-2021 for the moratorium period. So for after that date, regular stock statement is applicable. So you have to see the stock statement, then you have to arrange the DP, then if the penal interest has to be charged or not, and whether if the non-submission of stock statement for a period exceeding 3 months after moratorium, all regular norms, all IRAC norms are applicable. So this point you have to see.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Sir, in point number 5, DP has not affect submission stock statement. That means after the moratorium, we have checked the DP or not? After the moratorium period.
During moratorium period, you need not worry about the DP.
Sir, if we not consider DP, then what is the meaning of the stock statement? If the customer is not submitted the stock statement, then how we classify the account as NPA?
You have to ignore all workings during the moratorium. DP
can't ignore. Sir, I'm asking after the moratorium period.
Moratorium period, just wait. Yeah. Just wait. All IRAC norms are applicable, but with reference to stock, they say that it has to be regularized during the moratorium. If there is any omission of stock statement, that has to be regularized on or before 31-3. But for the month of September, you have to submit the stock statement during the month of August. For the month of August, you have to submit the stock statement during the month of November, because during the moratorium period, you have to ignore the stock statement. After that, as usual, the customers, they have to submit the stock statement to the branch.
Sir, that means we have considered the stock statement for the only NPA purpose, but we have not considered DP.
Yes, after you can say that for the following days, stock statements have not been received. But for the purpose of calculation, you calculate after 1-9. September, you have to, for 1-9, the 1-9 to 39, that is September month stock statement, you have to submit on or before 7th of October. Oh. For the sanction letter. Then October on or before 7-11. So, for the moratorium period, stock statement is being deferred. Submission of stock statement is being deferred.
Hello. Oh.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
This is Kumar Abel, sir. Actually, with respect to the FITL, if the interest is not served even after 90 days, whether it is NPA or not.
FITL, they say that the due
interest on FTL. You mean that you, I'm not asking about the repayment of loan. Further, the due date is 31st March 2021. That is a different thing. Originally, the FITL started by 1/9/2020.
Yes.
If the interest is not served even after 90 days, whether it is NPA or not.
Yes, automatically it will become NPA.
Yes, correct. Okay.
IRAC norms.
But yeah.
Now you can see on 39 itself, they are not, 31.8 itself, they are not, most of the bankers, they are not converted.
Okay, something they later. Okay.
So the date of creation of FITL agreement is very much important. Suppose during March 2021, say 24/3/2021, if FITL agreement is being created, there is no question of NPA.
Sorry, you repeat it.
Sir?
You please repeat it.
Sir, the Supreme Court has passed its order on 23/3/2021.
Correct.
Based on the Supreme Court order, the banks, they have created FITL.
Okay.
After the date. Where is the question of 90 days? It is not applicable. One, in case the bankers, as per the RBI circular, if already created an FITL, then 90 days concept is applicable.
Correct. Okay.
Thank you. Okay. And it's a very, very... happy that most of the members are coming with the questions. And after completion of this portion, then I'll be here for any number of time, any number of hours, you can ask any question. And is there any possibility for an answer to be standard as on 29/2023? That's Santa Lakshmi, please wait for the presentation. And last date for FITL agreement was 31/12/2020. That's why you just go through the surplus, the sanction letters issued by the Vikram. You just go through the sanction letter issued by the bank. Sometimes few bankers, they never even created the FITL. So date of creation of FITL is very, very important. From there, your IRAC norms are applicable. In case if it is 30/11/2020, if FITL agreement is being created, and if there no interest is being paid, so as on 31/3/2021, that account will be termed as NPA. FITL also will become NPA. And with reference to working capital elements, I'm going to the presentation. With reference to working capital elements, the account should be standard as on 29/2. Accumulated interest has to be converted into FITL, and that FITL has to be paid on or before 31/3/2020. Now, we are moving to term loan. This is where we have to give a lot of importance, concentration. Here, the scheme which I'm going to discuss are applicable to those persons who have availed the moratorium. So standard account, as usual, it is on 29/2020. You have to ignore moratorium. That's why I said you have to remove the moratorium period of 1/3/2020 to 31/8/2020 from your calendar. From 29/2020, directly it goes to 1/9. So if the account is 1/3 on 1/3/2020, if that account has become substandard, then the substandard date is 1/9/2020. This chart I'll discuss after this slide presentation. You can easily understand. And the status has got effect only after 31/8/2020. So there is no change of status. There is no downgrading of status during the moratorium. And if in case SMA-2 on 29/2020, it continuously enjoy the same benefits from 1/9/2020. If it is NPA, if it is a standard, then if it slips into NPA from 1/9/2020, you have to do the regular IRAC norms. So NPA falls in the middle of the moratorium period, we'll take, and you have to calculate from 1/9/2020. For this, I have already prepared the chart. I'll put it here. And after 1/9/20, all the IRAC norms applicable. That's why I said you remove the calendar, remove those 6 months from the calendar, then calculate IRAC norms. I'll go to the I prepared this chart, and this is according to me And you also refer if there is anything change in is being issued by the RBI, you please refer. So this chart I prepared yesterday night based on the present circular. And since you have to remove the NP, I mean moratorium, say I'll say that on 1-3, I'll take to here, I think 8, this one. From suppose first case is up to 29-2-2020, that account is standard. That is, it is in SMA 2. On 1-3-2021, as per the regular IRAC norm, that account has become NPA on 1-3-2020, we'll assume. And since the dates we have to remove from the calendar, that is during the moratorium period, the 1-3-2020 if any loan has become NPA on 1-3-2020, the new date of NPA is 1-9-2020. 2-3-2020, the new NPA date is 2-9-2020 for all the borrowers who have availed the moratorium. This is the chart. 3-3-2020, 3-9-2020. This chart I will share to you through the mail or through the WhatsApp. I'll share this chart to you. This will be useful to you because while calculating the NPA, if you found that, say, during the 26-5-2020, if a loan becomes NPA, and how to fix the new NPA date, it is on 26-11-2020. So in this manner, you have to calculate. This chart is applicable only for the term loan. This is not applicable for the CC. This chart is applicable for the term loan towards interest. Suppose if any loan of term loan has become an NPA due to non-payment of interest, installment, and EMI, this is the new date of NPA. How to fix the new date? And another thing here is the cash credit loan. If any cash credit loan, if it has not been renewed within 180 days from the due date, then that account has become NPA. So here, sometimes the loan renewal due date will fall between the moratorium period. During the moratorium period, any loan due renewal, CC renewal due date will fall. So same dates you can take. Suppose in case on 35-2020, if any loan, CC loan is due for renewal, that date you have to shift to 30-11-2020. From 30-11-2020, you have to add 180 days. So this chart is very, very important because it's a ready reckoner. It's a ready reckoner. When you go to the audit, if you find anything NPA during this period, then what is the due date of NPA? So that you have to put it because identifying NPA date is very, very important. That's why I have prepared this chart. This chart I will definitely share to you either on request or I'll share to you through the mail ID or I'll share to you through the WhatsApp and everything. So it will be useful. So this chart is useful for two things. One is term loan NPA date identification. Second one is CC renewal date identification. This chart is useful. I think if I got any doubt in this chart, you can ask. Bank ask third party collateral for CC account proprietary business and MODD done. Day onwards, the account are not good. Now the bank classified as NPA on. Sir, okay, if you, who has asked this question? Sendil Kumar, sir. Okay. Third party security is being given. Yes, I do agree. So that is with reference to sanction. If the account is not in operation as per the IRAC norms, then you can classify that account as NPA. Can we ask the bank to classify the loss asset? No. See, to classify the loss asset, one is the very important thing is erosion in property value only. You can directly take the property to loss asset. And provided the value should be less than 10%. Non-prepayment of loan, though the property belongs to a third party, will not make the account as loss asset. Only erosion of property value will take you to the loss. And my request to the fellow friends is that if you have got any doubt in this chart, you can ask.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Hello. Sir, moratorium period is in 6 months, not in 180 days, right, sir?
Yes, sir. It is 6 months. They say that it is not 6 months.
Sir, right.
One second, sir. The moratorium period is 1/2020 to 31/8/2020.
Okay. Sir, in your second column, in your third column, 12/4/2020, and date come to 13/10.
Okay. I do agree. See, here. Okay, just wait. Okay, here, 31/3/2020, see, September has got only 30 days.
Okay.
Okay, September has got 30 days. So, 31/3/2020,
110/2020.
Okay. Okay, okay. Okay, now you go here. You can see. See, 1 day has slipped. September has got 30, March has got 31 days.
Okay.
You can understand?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And I'll explain. See, it's a very good question, sir. Now you can see. See, April has got 30, but October has got 31.
Yes.
Yeah. 1/5 starts from 1/5, again 1/11. Yeah. November has got 30 days.
Right.
Huh?
Got it. Yes, sir.
Now here you can see 31/5 and 1/12. Because November has got 30 days.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Okay, I'll share this. It's a very good observation. And if CC under a brand sanction not renewed even after 180 days, is it okay if the manager renew it now or it should it be get the approval from credit, say Meenakshi? As for the RBI norms, if the loan is not renewed within 180 days from the date, due date of renewal, on 181st day, that account has become NPA. Whether they renew it now or not, after 3 years, after 2 years, that is immaterial. The date of NPA is 181st day is the NPA date. Now only they are renewing. So for the remaining 3 months, that account has to be treated as NPA. That's all. Sir, please cover one or two instances of personal loans and jewelry loans for the benefit of majority. Yes, sir, I'll cover, sir. After the presentation, I will cover Raghavendra, sir, no problem. You can ask me. If CC renewal does not in March, then it has become NPA. See, technical NPA is due date, you have to calculate from 180 days. Then only, that is 180 days from the due date of renewal. Then only that account becomes NPA. Suppose if the due date falls during the month of March 2021, that account is not to be treated as NPA. He, sir, they will prepare and the papers on backdated. So anything, Meenakshi, their question, there is no question of backdated, one. Second thing, they have to fit into the computer whether the limit is being renewed or not. If they put it backdated, if the computer charge penal interest, you can ask the manager why you are charged penal interest, and there is no question of backdated document because everything is system takes care of. If anything goes wrong, then the manager is in trouble. If they do it to avoid NPA, then it is equivalent to fraud. I am moving to the next to. If you got any doubt here,
hello. Yeah. Sir, I just want again one question. If CC's renewal date is 23/2020, that means 1 year. That means we come to the directly 29/2020 for the 1 year, and then after we count the 180 days, right, sir?
Yes. 180 days from 29/2020, you
had to calculate. Yes. Okay, sir.
Due date of renewal, you go to the sanction letter. Now, all the sanction letter contains the due date of renewal specifically.
Yes.
They are giving renewal date as for the some branch, some banks, they class, they say that the renewal date is for 18 months. Up to first fix the renewal date. From okay. there, add 180 days.
Okay.
This is very, very simple, sir. If the renewal date falls during the moratorium, let us take another example. If the renewal date falls during the moratorium, then you take the corresponding date, which is eligible to be renewed. Suppose if the renewal date falls on 13/7/2020, and the new renewal date is 13/1/2021, from there you have to add 180 days.
Okay, okay, sir. So
it's a thing you have to understand.
Yes, yes, thank you, sir.
Actually, to prepare this chart, I put some 3 hours.
Yes.
I understand. Then I put, based on this is my view. This is my view with reference to NPA due date identification. And next part. Now I have completed point number 6, and then after that IRAC norms are applicable. After that IRAC norms are applicable. This is for the persons who have availed the benefits of moratorium. Now I am going to the persons. Now I am going to the persons who have not availed the benefits. We have seen the benefits. Then ignore the moratorium date and all IRAC norms are applicable. And if you have not availed the benefits, then whether it is a term loan, whether it's a cash credit loan, the account should be standard as on 29/2020 as usual, but the payment starts on 1/9/2020. So there is no question of skipping to the other due dates. So if the loan is falls between a moratorium, the due date of renewal is 1/9/2020. Here, all interest fall due for the period. All interest that is during moratorium period, all the installments, all the interest, all EMI, everything the party has to pay on 1/9/2020. Then regular IRAC norms are applicable. From there, you have to calculate IRAC norms. But if you have already availed benefits, then you can convert those amount into FITL with reference to CC. And with reference to term loan, you can ask for the chart, you can do the calculation. So this is the only basic difference between two schemes. Those who have availed, if you have not availed the scheme, then the due date of the loan, due date of the interest, due date of the installment, due date of the EMI starts from 1/9/2020, whether you have availed term loan, whether you have availed the CC loan. And for this, there is no conversion of FITL. You have to avail the benefit. All interest starts from 1/9/2020. This is where most of the bankers, they say that the party has already availed itself, so we have not classified that account as NPA. So you have to ask whether the party has given the letter or not. This is a basic two thing you have to understand. This is very, very important.
Sir, usually that time bank actually sent SMS, if you want to avail moratorium, please send yes offer. To the...
It is an so offer. It is offer. An offer. Whether the party has accepted or not, for that there is a prescribed format. There is a prescribed form is there.
Okay.
Verify the form and you verify the date of availment.
Okay, okay. So it's not accepted through phone. It's not possible, right, sir? If it is opted through phone, SMS, if it is
opted... It is only an offer given by the banker to the customer. The banker, I mean customer, he has to accept, he has to come to the bank, he has to give a letter and he has to sign the documents with reference to moratorium.
Okay, sir. Okay, thank you. Okay.
So that's why you said there are two things, if you accept or not accept. If you are not accepting, due date starts from 1/9/2020, you calculate all IRAC norms. If I have availed moratorium, then step by step you can go. Sindhu Kumar asked, sir, in continuation of my question, third party collateral branch managers send ratification for the sanction letter, but the circle office has not given permission, but they transfer that account to NPA. Party did not submit any financial data till date, we feel something. Sir, Sindhil, they have sent one thing is you have to go through the sanction letter. Second thing, it's a third party property. Okay, no problem. If there is no operation in the account as per the IRAC norms, you have to classify that account as NPA. That's all. And if they transfer the account to NPA, okay, if they transfer the account to NPA, we need not bother. But only thing is whether that property is something fishy, and if you are suspect with the title of the property, you can go proceed for the further steps. But you need not bother. You need not bother because the NPA identification is there. And you have to see another point, whether it's a quick mortality account. Quick mortality account means within 1 year, if that account has become NPA, you have to go for the quick mortality. You have to do it. You have to do it with caution. That's all. If after 3 years, after 2 years, if that account has become NPA, don't worry. It's all normal thing.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Hello. Sir, I have only one query. Sir, if the client taking the moratorium period, okay, and he paid the 2 EMI in advance. Hello.
Tell me, sir.
Sir, if the client taking the monitoring period of 6 months, but he still paid the 2 EMI in advance, that means in monitoring payment, EMI is called as advance payment, or is set up again in monitoring EMI?
Sir, whether it is EMI, whether it is installment, whether it is interest, if you avoid the benefits, this is being skipped to the next two. After moratorium, you can do regular normal work.
And then, no, sir, I just want to know if in the time of moratorium period, if I am the client, I'm taking the moratorium, but unfortunately, I paid the advance of 2 EMI in moratorium only. Then the 2 EMI in moratorium is called as advance payment or is set off in a moratorium period.
So EMI you paid to the extent of interest. To the extent of interest, you have to the branch. They have to calculate only the simple interest. Correct. So you are paid EMI during moratorium. Correct.
Yes. Okay.
Normally, when you pay the EMI, EMI portion contains interest plus principal. Yes, now you have to consider only interest. Whether that is a simple interest or compound interest or interest on interest, you have to take only simple interest and not compound interest.
Okay.
So to the extent of compound interest, the excess interest that you have to either adjust towards the loan or to be refunded to the partner.
Okay.
Am I clear, sir?
Okay. Yes.
Yeah. Thank you. If they are paying interest on installment on 1/9/2020, does not mean that they are all availing. Sir, Srinivasan, you can pay the amount. You can pay the amount. If you pay the amount regularly, there is no question of NPA. It's only NPA identification that we are discussing. So on moratorium, if you are not availing the moratorium, all the payments are due from 1/9/2020. All installments, all interest, all EMI. That's the thing. If they are paying interest on installment, okay. If they paid on 1/9/2020, it's on regular basis. You can do it. You can go ahead. After 1/9/2020, regular IRAC norms are applicable. What is the auditor's role? What is the auditor's role here? Can backdate will be acceptable? What's the question? What is your role during the audit this year? These 6 points you have to be very, very careful. See, no interest on interest, compound interest, and penal interest as they have applied, branch has applied during the moratorium. Because if they apply, then it's a violation of. Whatever interest they paid, excess interest in the form of interest on interest, compound interest, or penal interest, it has to be either refunded or adjusted to the loan. This is also another auditor's role during this year. And FITL, you have to see as FITL conversion, you have to see whether there's a separate agreement is there or not. You have to see from the you have to see from the agreement date, then only you have to convert. So FITL conversion, that is you have to convert the interest debited during the moratorium period from 1/3/2020 to 31/8/2020, you have to convert into FITL loan. And interest you can apply continuously. Then whether a borrower has availed the benefit or moratorium or not, that that you have to see, you have to verify the letter. And you have to verify another thing, verify whether the standard, the asset is standard as on 29/2/2020. That is also your role. Please do it. And any upgradation done due to, due to payment on or before 31/3/2021, and a friend already asked, suppose if they pay on 1/9/2020 all the amount, then that account has to be treated as standard only. So whether any upgradation is done, that means the account has become substandard, and you have to see whether from substandard to standard, if any upgradation is done, then you have to see whether the borrower has paid all the amount on time or not. That's a very, very important thing that you have to see during this year audit. And upgradation, I want to say one thing here, fellow members, it starts from D3 to D2, no upgradation, D2, D1, no upgradation. Actually, if you want to classify one account as substandard, from D3 to standard, you can take on payment of amount. So upgradation is possible only in this direction and not on from D3 to D2. There is no question of upgradation. That's why I asked, I already said in my previous presentation, you have to go and ask the last year NPA statement, this year NPA statement, and compare it. If last year the statement says D1, this year the statement should be D2. So in case the last year the statement says D1 and this year also the statement is D1, that means they are not downgraded. So this is a way in which bankers avoid NPA, few bankers. I cannot blame all bankers. So the skidding to downgrading, you have to be very, very careful. Suppose last year standard, this year also standard, okay. But you have to see whether that account is standard or not, one. And last year substandard, this year you have to take to D1 or not D2, so D1. So after D1, it should be D2. If suppose last year D1, if this year also it is D1, that means they have not downgraded those accounts. So this point you have to bear in mind, and what that is auditor's role. And one second, two questions I have received. I'll answer and come back. If interest in March 1, that is Amar sir asked, if interest in March 1, 20 to August 21 is in 1 lakh, and I paid the advance amount of in this month of say 50,000, then what FITL amount, remaining amount, after if I pay 50,000 interest out of 1 lakh, FITL will be only 50,000, it is not 1 lakh. So out of 1 lakh interest, 50,000 is being paid towards interest. Then remaining only will be termed as FITL because you have already made the payment. What they say that only the penal interest on interest only be returned and not the actual interest paid.
But sir, in my case, I pay the 50,000 against the EMI amount, not against the interest amount. Then how bank set up the same amount?
You pay the EMI, correct?
Yeah.
EMI portion, you exclude principal.
Okay.
You exclude principal, only interest is applicable.
Okay. Interest is set up.
EMI is a combination of principal plus interest. Exclude principal. Then there's a chart. You go and ask the chart from the branch, they will produce. What is the interest amount?
Okay.
So you paid in full. So to the extent of EMI, you exclude principal. And concentrate only on interest. The remaining interest only you can convert into FIT.
Right. And sir, that is principal amount is in code is advance payment.
Principal amount is being adjusted towards loan. There is no advance payment. Advance payment means you paid interest. Bankers they charged interest.
Uh-huh.
Basis. on interest on interest on penal interest. If you make the payment,
okay,
the Supreme Court says that you have to do the payment on these simple interest. So whatever amount excess paid, that has to be adjusted, and not okay. the not the principal.
Okay, and so that means I paid the 2 EMI or principal amount that is adjusted against the future EMI, na? After moratorium EMI.
Okay, whatever outstanding, see EMI is for the easy purpose of making the payment by the borrower. So if you pay the installment in advance, that will be deducted from your future payments.
Okay, okay.
Okay, if FITL conversion done after 1/1/2021. Not paid interest by 31/3. See, 1/1/2021. Yes, if the FITL is being converted on 1/1/2021, so January interest will be applicable paid only on 31/1/2021. So there is no question of 90 days. So that account will not become NPA. That is Manisha Ratho's question, and Mihir asked. If one account slipped to NPA during the year, but at the year end, part payment made to upgrade, what should be our stand? Mithir, it's a very, very simple logic. Once you identify one account as NPA, if you want to upgrade the NPA account, then the borrower has to make the payment till date, all the dues, and not 90 days. Suppose if two dues he has remitted, and if he has not paid the third due, then that account has continued to be classified as NPA. Because if you want to upgrade from substandard to standard, all the dues as on 31/3/2021 has to be paid. Then only that account has to be converted into standard. Otherwise, no upgradation is possible. And sir, while calculating the FITL sanction, they would have taken the compound interest. Yes. Yes, sir. That's why we can reverse in the form of MOC, Meenakshi, Ramaya. We can convert. We can say that if any FITL agreement can be done to any extent, that is before Supreme Court order, they passed it. Supreme Court said that no interest on interest. So whatever amount excess paid, that has to be reversed. In the form of MOC. If the banks, they have already reversed, you need not bother. If they are not reversed, you can do this in the form of MOC and give and adjust to the either as a principal or you can recommend for the repayment. So while calculating FITL sanction, they would have been common. Yeah. So any renewal then. So any renewal to be done, no reversal has to be done. Reversal has to be done, Meenakshi. And we are moving to the next part of the presentation. Benefits, there is no distinction between FITL sanction, they would have taken compound interest, right? So any reversal to be done, it's a very, very simple, sir. So before Supreme Court order, the banks, they have charged interest on interest or penal interest or compound interest during the moratorium. All the moratorium, that is moratorium interest is being converted into FITL. While during the audit, you observe that the branch has charged interest on interest, you have to give recommendation towards reversal of the interest through MOC. This can be given a recredit to the account. That means you have refunded the amount to the part. Meenakshi ma'am, correct? I understand. Okay, now there is no distinction between agricultural term loan, agricultural CC, non-agricultural term loan, non-agricultural CC. But for again, once again, for your special interest, I have given the same thing. Term loan. As usual, you have to do IRAC norms working for the agricultural loans. If the agricultural loan due date falls during the moratorium, and if the borrower has availed the moratorium, the due date shifting should be there. And if it is a CC account, this moratorium CC interest, there is interest charged during moratorium have to be converted into FITL. That's all. There is no distinction between, they say that it's a term loan. they say that it's a CC loan. There is no distinction between agriculture and non-agriculture. Same thing is here. And benefits not availed, both agriculture and non-agriculture. Okay, the agriculture, they have not availed. So term loan and interest installment due during the moratorium falls on 1/9/2020. You calculate NPA accordingly. Working capital interest, all the interest falls on 1/9/2020. And for regarding agricultural, you have to do the agricultural classification based on the IRAC norms that is applicable for the short-term loan and short-term loan and long-term loan category. You have to do it, and you have to if it is a KCC, just like CC, you have to do it. And please refer this. I have already discussed in the NPA presentation and my earlier seminar. You go through it. You go through NPA classification, which I had in the earlier days. This is available in my YouTube. You can go through it and you can see. And FITL loan outstanding as on 31/3/2020, whether NPA or added to EMI for collection. What's it? If FITL outstanding as on 31/3/2021, if FITL outstanding, whether NPA or added to EMI. No. FITL is to be treated as a separate loan. Regular term loan is different. CC loan is different. Only for the interest portion, they have converted into FITL. There is no period. So they say that before 31/3/2021, it has to be paid. It, just like bullet payment. If it is not paid on or before 31/3/2021, from there you add 90 days. Say 90 days falls on April 30, May. So June 29th, that account will become NPA. If 31/3, this is the lookout of the next year auditor and not this year auditor. So you have to see only thing whether there is any any conversion of FITL is there or not. And date of identifying the FITL is very, very important. And now you opening the flow, you can ask any questions I can give the answer either through chat box or through you can unmute and you can speak. What is the interest rate applicable on FITL and to be recognized as an interest rate applicability? Kindly go and see the sanction letter issued by the branch. It varies from bank to bank, varies from commercial banks, scheduled banks. Varies. So please refer the sanction letter and get the interest applicability rate. So again, once again, repeat.
Hello, sir.
Yes, sir. Tell me. Yes, sir.
To ask whether take stock.
So voice is not clear, sir.
To take stock means after moratorium.
Sir, voice is not clear. Okay, I think you put it in the chat box, sir. I'll answer immediately. Regarding Uday,
okay, sir. Okay.
Yeah, because your audio is not clear. What's that? Members they asked. Gayatri Jain asked regarding Udayam registration submission. The effective date is 1st April 2021. So till 31/3/21. Yeah, they say that before 31/3/2021, all the SSI, EM, Entrepreneur Memorandum, and Udayam Aadhar registration, all these things have to be converted and into Udayam registration form. So if it is produced on or before 31/3/2021, you need not bother. If they have not converted, then you have to give that point in your LFAR that Udayam registration certificate is not available for verification. So penal interest will be applicable from 1/9 to the Srikanth sir, absolutely you are correct. Penal interest rate is applicable from 1/9/2020 and not during moratorium as per the Supreme Court order. And Santa Lakshmi asked, banks have the practice of closing FITL before 31/3/2021 and open another loan account. Is it correct, sir? If FITL loan is being if it, the FITL loan has to be closed, it has to be closed out of genuine source. If one loan is given to close FITL loan, that is the way in which they are avoiding NPA. So this is the this point the next year auditor he has to take care, because if any FITL has to be closed, it has to be closed out of genuine source and not out of loans sanctioned. This point you have to see. Then Achyudhan sir asked, can banks add full amount of EMI, both interest and principal, during the moratorium and make it a loan? No, only the Supreme Court says only the interest and not the principal to be added into FITL and converted. It is called as funded interest term loan. So principal cannot be added, but the due date you have to change according to the IRAC norms. So was there any date limit for application and sanction of FITL? Yes, initially they say that it is 31-12, but anyhow, you please refer the concerned bank circular and see whether the FITL agreement has been created as per the respective bank's head office norms or not. Please go through the circular and do it. Sir, will this be uploaded in your YouTube? Yes, sir. I have given for the recording. I don't know whether it's being recorded or not. I'll definitely see that this will be uploaded in the YouTube. Is it possible to share the presentation, Srinivasan? And a few members, they asked about the PPT, but PPT is my property. But everything is there in the YouTube, in the former slide. You can find my PPT. It's not, Srinivasan sir, don't mistake me. Whether to take stock statement after moratorium? Yes, sir. You have to take Mihir. You have to see the stock statement. It should be submitted after moratorium. As per one slide, it is mentioned that to regularize before 31/3/2021, that is during the moratorium stock statement, that has to be regularized on or before 31/3/2021, and not after that date, not after 1/9/2021. All after 1/9/2021, regular IRAC norms are applicable. That doesn't mean the need to take. Yeah, no. They have to stock statement. They have to submit the stock statement, and submission of stock statement during moratorium is being postponed to 31/3/2021. Explain the concept of bullet repayment loan. Bullet repayment. What is bullet? Sure. So immediately and one shot, you have to close the loan. That is called as bullet repayment. Madhiraju. In one payment, so just like 31/3/2021 FITL, it has to be closed on or before 31/3/2021. There is no monthly payment, there is no days payment. In one shot, they have to close it. So that is called as bullet repayment. Regarding, I think let's ask this question. Regarding, I think Gayatri asked, regarding certification of unhedged foreign currency exposure, if applicable accounts, 1 crore has not been given self-declaration for the same. How we'll sign the certificate? Can we modify the statement? Sir, Gayatri, please refer the circular regarding this certificate. And you ask the manager, they will definitely produce the copy. And what are the instructions that they have given? Please go and do it accordingly. You don't modify whatever thing. Whatever statement they produce, you have to accept. But whatever modification you want to give, put it in the MOC, Memorandum of Changes, and don't ask them to modify. And because this certificate has already been gone to the head office, so whatever certificate you want to certify, you certify with the qualification that this is subject to MOC. In that manner, you have to give the certificate. And Ashutosh Sharma, if due date falls in moratorium period, what shall be the NPA date? Yes, sir. If the due date falls, due date of, is it NPA due date or loan due date? So you have to shift the due date to the next day. That's why I have given a very big chart. If the benefits have been availed by the borrower, then you have to do the working accordingly. You can shift the due date as per the chart to the next day. After 6 months, say after 180 days, you have to shift. Standard on 29/2020, substandard on 31/3/2020, then how to proceed? So, Santhaleshmi, you have to ignore the substandard period. during moratorium. You can shift to 31-3 means the due date is 1/10/2020. Because that is why I have prepared a chart. In that chart, I will share the chart to you through mail or through WhatsApp. You go through it and then you can easily understand. Don't bother about the NPA that has come during the moratorium period. You have to shift it. The due date falls on moratorium, what should be the NPA date? You have to shift it. Standard as on, okay. Next one is Gantipudi. Sir, please repeat the due dates for submission of stock statement pertaining to, sir, don't worry about the stock statement that does due during the moratorium. The moratorium stock statements have to be submitted to the bank on or before 31-3, only moratorium. And after that, say September stock statement, they have to submit during October. Only this they have, they say that it has to be regularized before 31-3. That is a submission of stock statement for the period of moratorium. It has to be regularized on or before 31-3. When a gold loan account become NPA, please see the due date of the loan. If the gold loan, if it is agricultural loan, gold loan, then regular agricultural IRAC norms are applicable. And the purpose of gold loan, whether the gold loan is agricultural purpose, if it is a direct agricultural 2 years concept, that is cultivating period, to whether it's for short term or long term, you have to do it. With reference to agriculture, non-agricultural gold loan, 90 days are norms are applicable. For agricultural gold loan, regular agricultural loan classifications are applicable. Sir, moratorium can be given to, Meenashi asked, moratorium can be given to all borrowers or to only those affected by COVID? No. See, should we exercise any judgment? No, no, Meenashi, there is no question of exercising the judgment. The RBI said you can avail the moratorium. If the party accepts, yes, yes, accepted. If the party has not accepted, leave it. If the party has not accepted, the due date is being fixed on 1/9/2020. There is no disparity during the moratorium. If in the physical verification on cash in CDM, there's a difference which is not reconciled by the branch, we should, yes, if there is any cash difference in the between the cash book and the vault book or anything, then that has to be reported in the LFIR. And if it is a serious matter, please repeat, please produce that at that point, you know, main report, because LFIR says that there is anything material, that point you can cover it in the LFIR. And thank you, Meenashi, ma'am. And is there, if anyone asks any question, yeah, KCC NPA date, regular, two. If two crop season ended during moratorium period, then shift, that's all. What is the crop season during the moratorium period? That is that date. You have to refer the ready reckoner date. Then you have to shift that due date. From there, you have to do the calculation, NPA working. KCC, I think Ashwath Sharma, I think whatever due date that falls between the moratorium, you please ignore it. You have to shift that date to other period, to the regular thing. Yeah. And thank you very much. And almost it is 12:57. And thank you very much for your patient hearing. And whatever doubt, my mail ID is with you. You can ask. How certification of ATM and cash balance? You please ask the manager to produce the certificate. Currency chest, what the point we have to see, Ashutosh. Please go and see P&L account and balance sheet. Based on that, you do the audit. Yeah, whether it's a processing center or whether it's a chest branch. We are going to certify only P&L account and balance sheet. You
hello.
On all those points that has been
hello.
That have been mentioned in the P&L. Yeah.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Sir, if there is a cash difference, if there is a cash difference between the vault and the cash book,
yes.
So that is a loss to the bank and MOC has to be passed to that effect?
You see, I can say whether you can say it's a fraudulent thing or not. One thing. And second thing, what's the amount of difference, sir?
Sir, whatsoever, but that is a loss. If it is a
yes, that has to be reimbursed. See, as per book, it is 1 lakh, but cash on hand 95,000. So who has to refund that 5,000? So the cashier or officer.
So sir, if that is not, if that is not recoverable from anyone, then it is a loss to the bank and appropriate ABC has to be passed to that effect.
So any debit due to loss in because of shortage, that has to be approved by the head office. It is a loss, but the cashier is responsible. The key holders are responsible because they are holding the key. They are responsible. I think for me, there is no such thing due to this shortage and no one is responsible. You cannot say only the cashier and the officer who are the joint custodian, they are responsible for the deficit in cash.
Hey, sir, in my case, there was cash received from currency chest.
Huh?
So cash was received from currency chest and the appropriate entity was parked in interbank transaction. But the next day, when cash was counted, there was shortfall of 10 lakh rupees, okay. Suppose.
Who has received the cash? See, and when the currency chest cash comes to the branch, the person who has was authorized the transaction is responsible for the repayment. Because as per the rule, whatever cash comes into the branch, that has to be checked. Then only that cash has to be kept inside the vault. So without checking, if the cash is being kept inside the locker, inside the vault, then the cashier who has acknowledged the receipt of the cash, he is responsible for the loss.
Okay. Okay.
If the vault, chest branch, they remitted the cash, but they say that pending for verification, then the loss has to be borne by the chest branch and not by this branch.
Okay.
Okay, sir.
Right.
When insurance is there for cash, should we pass that for the different? You have to prove that there's a loss due to, say, normally the insurance, if there is any dacoity is there, any dacoity action has taken place, then insurance comes into the picture. And because when the cash is being handed to the cashier, then cashier is responsible till the same is being kept in the vault. And now, in the after keeping the cash into the vault, if there is any difference, the joint key holders are responsible. And in case of any fire, then you can claim insurance. And Kantipuri Satyanarayan says, how certification of ATM cash balance as on 31/3/21 is possible on the data? See, you have to get your certification as on the date of your visit. And you can see 31/3/21 and the balance sheet. But if you are going to the audit on 4th of April, then you have to get the certificate as on 4th of April and you need not get the certificate on 31/3/2021. Okay, friends, and thank you very much. I'm closing the session. And whatever, I want to do the successful audit. I wish you everyone and be happy with the audit and carry your food and be safe because of this COVID situation. Sir, Surinarayan, I already said sharing of PPT is not possible from my side because this PPT is available in the YouTube. You can go through it. And don't mistake me, sir. Don't mistake me. And just I'm closing the session for want of time. And we will meet you once again. Anyhow, I'll definitely meet you and wish you all the best in the bank audit. And whatever doubt you got, you can ask me. No problem.